I shall begin with a title in French, Vive la gourmandise éclairée. Anybody among English speakers can know what Vive la France or Vive la gourmandise can mean. It's let's celebrate. Gourmandise, I did not find any translation. Éclairée means enlightened. Of course, in this discussion, it would be enlightened by science. So Vive la gourmandise éclairée. I want to show you some what are called old wives' tales. For example, it was written 2 centuries ago by Grimaud Larenière that when you roast suckling pigs, the head should be cut at the end of cooking, otherwise the skins become soft. And indeed, for this kind of meat, the real gourmand need a very crisp skin. So is it true that when you cut the head of the suckling pigs, suddenly the skin is better? This is very surprising, because when you cut the head, there is no reason why the rear part should be different. Anyway, the experiment was done, and this culinary old wives' tales was proved true, which was very surprising. By the way, you can see that I did not write old wives' tales in this slide, but culinary precisions. Indeed, there are many, many words in French, in English, in German, and so on, about old wives' tales, tips, methods, and so on. So this is why I propose to group all of them under the name culinary precisions. I should not be able to explain today why they are precisions, but indeed they are added on the definition. So let's go on with other culinary precisions. For example, it is said that in France only, it is said that when a woman has her period, the mayonnaise fails. True? Wrong? Let's do an experiment. Is it said also that you should avoid absolutely any presence of egg white in the mayonnaise, so otherwise it fails? Let's do the experiment now. In order to see the experiment, we need an egg, which is not very expensive. And we shall decide to have all together the egg white and the yolk, because if a parcel, a very tiny drop of egg white can make the mayonnaise fail, well, then we need to whip. Generally, chefs or cooks are using one whisk, but why not two? Because if one is more efficient, there is perhaps a reason why two are better. Let's use better. I invite you to make the experiment. So we begin by whipping the mixture. We add a drop of oil, we whip, and we see that this oil can mix with the water from the egg white. Perfectly, there is no, or perfectly, apparently, because the microscope can show that there are indeed oil droplets dispersed into water. So now we whip more oil, more oil, more oil. By the way, it is said that the temperature is important, but I did not do anything about temperature. It is said that you should whip always in the same direction. Let's do the reverse. It is said so many things that it is very interesting that so many people discuss so many things about a simple sauce like mayonnaise. Okay, and now add more oil, more oil, more oil. The consistency is changing, and now it's almost done. Let's look. You see, we have a mayonnaise. It's not very solid, but it's a mayonnaise. So let's add more, 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 more. It turns white suddenly, and now it's done. We have a wonderful mayonnaise. If I'm whipping more efficiently, it would be more firm. But there is no problem about the presence of egg white. So this is a big question. Why did so many smart people write books about cooking, and they wrote wrong sentences, wrong ideas, wrong culinary precision? This is a big mistake. So now let's come back to the big question of cooking. We have culinary books, or we have chefs. There are many, many recipes, many, many lines, and we can doubt of any words written in this book. So is it true or not? Of course, we should do experiments. This experiment was about cheese soufflé.
Indeed, it was not only two cheese soufflé. It was two cheese soufflé every day for 1 month. And here the comparison was among very firm egg whites and non-firm egg whites. Three-star chefs say that you get a big soufflé if the egg white is not very firm. Some other chefs say that you need to have the very firm egg whites to have a big soufflé. And indeed, it's true, for reasons that I don't have time to explain. Now, we can make categories. Some culinary precisions seems right and are right. Some seems right and are wrong. Some seems wrong and are right, and seems wrong and are wrong. And there is around culinary precision when you don't know. So we need to do something. Of course, we need to do something for education, because it's very important when you teach how to cook. What can you say? You need to tell the truth. So we need first investigation and knowledge. And this is why science is so important. What does it mean? It means that one of the founding fathers of modern science, says you need an experiment first, and then you need calculation. This is science. There is a method. The method is the following. You arrive, you walk in nature, and suddenly you have a phenomenon. Here is a mountain. There are no mountains everywhere, but here is a mountain. Why is there a mountain? And the scientist is looking for the mechanisms of phenomena. Why is there a mountain? In order to study the mechanism of phenomena, there is a method. And the method was invented centuries ago. It was perfected, but it is the following. First, number one, you look at the phenomenon. Number two, you make measurements. Number three, you group these measurements into synthetic laws. Number four, you make theories, explanations. Number five, because the theories are wrong, you make an experimental prediction. Number six, this experiment, and you hope that you were wrong, because you can go on and on and on, and you improve the theory. And science is wonderful because you propose theories that you know perfectly that they are wrong. This is a very strange behavior, but it is science. For cooking, with my late friend Nicolas Curti, professor of physics in Oxford, we introduced molecular gastronomy 20 years ago. And molecular gastronomy is you look at all phenomena that are occurring during cooking, and you make science out of it. So this is molecular gastronomy. Just one example. We studied with Juan Valverde, but many other students, we studied the change of color of green beans. When you cook green beans, they change the color. Why? First of all, we have to say that chlorophyll does not exist. There are chlorophylls. There are various different molecules. I will not go into details, but these molecules are responsible for part of the color. There are other molecules responsible for part of the color. For example, carotenoids, molecules that are yellow, orange, red, and all these molecules together make the green color of green beans. But indeed, this color is changing with time. We measure this evolution. And the question is, why does green mean? Because if you look very carefully at a green bean, at the section of a green bean, you see that this part is not the same green as this one and not the same green as this one. So we have to design methods for measuring the color at various parts. Of course, we can make many things. All the tools of science are useful, of chemistry and of physics are useful to characterize the green color. For example, we introduce a method using a tabletop scanner just to determine the content in pigments from the green beans. And here you see what are called thin layer chromatography. We make it quantitative. We also use some more complex methods like nuclear magnetic resonance. Here is a spectrum from nuclear magnetic resonance. This is only to show you that indeed molecular gastronomy is science. It is not cooking. Gastronomy means knowledge. Cooking means cooking. Science produces knowledge, and cooking produces dishes. So it's very different. With this tool, we studied many things, blanching the beans, the effect of temperature, duration of cooking, and so on and so on. Is salt important? Acidity? And indeed, here is the kind of result that we have daily in our lab. We measure the color, the evolution when we cook, and we have the content in pigments after 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. So this is molecular gastronomy. And it produces knowledge. So you have science, molecular gastronomy producing knowledge. Of course, there are applications, and there are two kinds of applications. First, education, because if you produce a new knowledge, then you will be able to teach differently. And if you produce new knowledge, also you can apply it in your kitchen. And this is very important. For example, one simple experiment. Okay, now one new application of molecular gastronomy, of knowledge, let's say. You want to boil an hard-boiled egg, and you want to get the yolk exactly at the center. Where is it? If you have a small quantity of knowledge, it is very easy to predict the result, because the egg white is more or less water plus 10% proteins, and the egg yolk is 15% water plus a certain amount of fat. So I can predict that the yolk is floating in the egg. Is it true? Just look. You open the upper part like this, and you just look, and there is a yolk at the top part of the egg. So it's very easy to make an hard-boiled egg with a yolk at the center. Where is the yolk? Up. How can you avoid to have the yolk at the top part? Just roll the egg with a spoon during cooking, and then you will have a perfect hard-boiled egg. So this is the kind of application that you can make daily from molecular gastronomy. Of course, there are many others. For example, molecular cooking, very fashionable those days, means new tools, new ingredients, new methods. So here you have some tools that we use daily in chemistry lab, and that will be very helpful in the kitchen. There are many other possibilities. Liquid nitrogen to make ice creams. They are wonderful ice creams, so please don't hesitate to use liquid nitrogen. Now, a big new idea for the next 10 years or 20 years. You know that when you cook traditionally, you're using fruits, plants, meat, and fish. And all these ingredients, food ingredients, are indeed mixtures. For example, here is a NMR spectrum, nuclear magnetic resonance spectrum, of a carrot. What you can see mostly are sugars, amino acids, organic acids, and so on. But this is a mixture. I just made a picture for you now. This is a mixture of some of the compounds of the carrot. So a carrot is a mixture. So if you cook traditionally, you're mixing a mixture and a mixture. Well, what if you're not happy of your carrot? Indeed, the cooks know what to do. They just add one compound, for example, sucrose, sugar, ordinary sugar. And when the carrot is missing some sugar, you add some sugar. But now, if you are playing a chord, notes together, plus one note, why not note by note, compound by compound? Okay. This is the idea, compound by compound. What could be the notes for cooking? Water, very easy. Tartaric acid is wonderful, very elegant acidity. Glucose, it's sweet. Glycerol, it's unctuous. Phenolics, they are said to be good for your health. Is it true? I'm not sure. Ethanol, everybody likes it. Children love sucrose, which is saccharose or sucrose, which is table sugar. Should we be afraid of all these compounds? Because there is a spirolactone bridge here. Indeed, these molecules are present in caramel. So if you eat caramel, you could play with that in your kitchen for the note-by-note cooking. And there are many others. For example, the Maillard reactions are producing a lot of compounds that you could probably use in your kitchen in order to make note-by-note cooking. Of course, if you just mix them, you won't be able to have a consistency. So you need to build the consistency. This is a gelatin gel under the microscope. And making a gel is very important because we are gels. So meat is a gel. Vegetables are gels. So we need gels. Here are some shallots, gels, because it means water trapped into cells. This is a solid. A shallot is a solid. A carrot the same. So gels are very important. In 2002, I invented a new machine called the PianoCTEL. The PianoCTEL has pumps and microreactors, and with these devices, you can make, you can have formula and make dishes. This is a dish made from a formula. This is the same machine driven by a computer. Here are the six pumps. Here are the results. Is it the cooking for tomorrow, cooking of the future? I don't know. I don't know because today we are still there. Just like in the Middle Age, we are roasting chicken. This is a big question. Why are we roasting chicken? Why are we still using the same tools that in the Middle Age? Very surprising. And there are many other questions. For example, everybody loves a good barbecue. But a good barbecue is full of benzopyrenes, which are very cancerogenic and toxic molecules. Very strange. So we eat toxic ingredients, and we love them. For example, in chocolate, chocolate is fat and sugar. The Munster cheese for Alsatian people is wonderful, but for the Asian, it's awful. On the contrary, the brain of a monkey, for me, it would be awful, but probably for some other people, it would be good. Now, there are many other questions. For example, this Romane Conti or the Chateau Petrus, we never ask the question whether if there are toxic molecules inside. We just love these wines. And now, the worst, basil and tarragon contain a lot of these molecules, methyl chavicol or estragol. This estragol has been demonstrated to be genotoxic and cancerogenic. This is sure, and this is a big question. Should we keep basil and tarragon or avoid it? I want to reassure you, there was no epidemiological study showing that people eating basil and tarragon were dying more than the other. So this is the question. Now, for the future, enough with toxicity. Let's have some pleasure. Is it possible that science and cooking go hand by hand? This is the proposal. The proposal, and indeed we do it already for years with my friend Pierre Gagnère. Here is the restaurant, here is the team, here is Pierre. Every month I'm introducing a new invention that I'm giving for free on the internet site of Pierre Gagnère. And Pierre is doing a recipe with that. For example, here is a foie gras chantilly. Now you have a libic. Now you have a nolet salad. Now you have a kinsheim sauce. Now you have an abstract dish. Now you play with hydrolysis of collagenic tissue. Here is a Wöhler sauce with lobster. Here is a Schitao dish. Here is a Würz. Here is a wind crystals. Here is a gips. And now is a torrefied flour. And finally, this is one of the first note-by-note dish of the history of cooking. You have now another view of this dish. It was shown for the first time in Hong Kong the 24th of April, 2009. And I'm very happy that my friend Pierre Gagnère was the first to produce this dish because this is a big event in the history of cooking. So, finally, I come back to French. Vive la gourmandise éclairée.